Dauntless bosses, the big bad endgame monsters of this Monster Hunter-like experience. When I made my Should You Play Dauntless 2021 video, it did cover main aspects of the game after a good chunk of playtime. But people were asking me in that, what about the endgame? You know, the highest level monsters, the most recent content, are they good? Does it live up to Monster Hunter in any way? Is it comparable? Well, welcome back to Rage Gaming. My name is Hollow, and today we're going to talk about that. You see, my biggest complaint with Dauntless monsters were when you're in a group, especially in the early and mid game, things become a bit of a sponge fight with simple mechanics behind them. Things did get more interesting as the devs did progress though and released new monsters and new deviant versions and up the ante. And that's really shown when we look at the biggest and best the game has to offer, the escalation bosses and of course the newest behemoth. These are monsters that I've enjoyed so much and I think would be really cool to see something of their type in Monster Hunter one day. Unique mechanics, unique designs, even their arenas are really cool. And I think things are looking very good for Dauntless if we see more of these types of monsters in the future of the game. So these are my five favorite behemoths in Dauntless, starting from the bottom at five. It's Ursker. A simple and cool design, it's literally a frost panther with huge frost horns that he can actually grow when he's charged up. It's set in this cave that we're fighting all the way at the end of a valley we've just overcome in the frost escalation, where this guy is going to use the environment in important ways to his advantage. Just looking at him, you might see a cool combination of say Magnum Mallow or Vulcana with the frost armor and the frost shots or spears he creates, while using the tail like a spear, such as Magna does. And while this is the most recent of the hard escalation bosses, he's actually fifth on this list from me because of the freeze mechanic that takes over the fight a lot. You see, in this escalation, you've got to manage your heat levels to prevent freezing, which is a good concept and does work really well. But obviously, they wanted to use that in the final fight. So, Ursker has a lot of attacks and abilities that are set around trying to freeze you, rather than necessarily this being a direct fight. It makes for a unique experience of managing your heat while overcoming the big monster that's on his turf, a bit of an uphill battle. But ultimately, being frozen a lot as a new player felt less of a spectacle and more just, you know, watching. Still, there's a lot going on in the fight. For example, each player at the very beginning of the escalation chooses a boon that works differently to generate heat throughout that escalation. And obviously, that ties to the final fight. Some of his coolest attacks are how he's gonna try to freeze you and catch you out while being surprisingly mobile, dashing and charging around, even leaping up to the ceiling for various ambush attacks. So, staying on top of him seems super important because of that. Mobility and speed is actually rewarded here, which is unique and fun, since it often isn't. This guy is going to blast you with his frost breath and it'll knock you out of your hotspots. He'll throw ice shards to freeze you. He'll even explode the ground under him for instant freezes you've got to avoid. You'll see him climb to the ceiling and then suddenly leap back down or charge around, so you've always got to keep your eyes on him. He can slam the ground to cause tons of icicles to fall from the ceiling. Suddenly you're dealing with like a freeze bullet hell. He'll whip you with a tail in a spin attack, juggling you in the air before slamming you down. And one of my favorite concepts of the fight reminds me of actually Vulcana, in which Ursker generates ice on the end of his tail like a spear to use in various ways. He'll stab you, he'll throw it at you, or he'll plunge it into the ground, and then that'll suddenly spike out at you at massive range. And of course, his super ability to drop a giant ice shard from the ceiling, causing a sort of freezing shockwave you've got to iframe through at the exact right moment. So yeah, he's got a lot going on. In many ways, he's going to try and freeze you, which does create a different atmosphere and playstyle for the fight, unlike anything else in the game. But because of that, it does feel like less of a direct fight, and that's why I put him as number five. But next up then, at fourth place, this is the giant mushroom infested tree, Agarus. Just like the frost escalation, the area design for this whole terror escalation is incredible. You can see how far they've come from the shock escalations to the frost and terror, where we now have a creepy, broken, infested forest filled with mushrooms compared to the shock escalation, which is kind of just a bare area you go through. For me though, this fight is more of a spectacle than say a monster hunt, and I like that because it feels like they're trying to break up what you would normally do and what you'd normally expect. It really feels like the devs have got more creative with their designs as they've progressed the game. It's like a living vine monster, so it's actually a relatively static fight. The monster's not going to move around too much, but because of that, it has massive range on its whipping, slamming, and spinning attacks using its huge arms around the arena. Have you noticed how his right arm's a lot bigger than his left arm? I wonder what that's about. It's a pretty weird design, but it makes for a very fun boss battle. So no matter where you are, you've got to be careful since the range of its attacks are massive. He'll spin the vines and hit anyone near, so you have to have good dodge timings. He can reach out at huge range and entrap trap you in roots. He'll dig under the ground and create huge earthquakes in sort of cone attacks. And throughout the fight, there's going to be lots of toxic pools to avoid, unless you're a fan of poison, even under Agarus himself, so ideally you're attacking his arms rather than his body. And that all makes for an interesting battle, but it's really good when he aether charges, where he suddenly creates a protective green bubble, which knocks everyone away, and then spreads out giant roots in different directions that have to be destroyed on a time limit. This cuts the arena into sections, and inside of those sections you've got acid pools to dodge, acid shots are going to come out from the boss himself, tracking you for a bullet hell, there's shrooms to pop before they spread even more acid, and if you do pop those quick, they'll reveal air vents, which then let you jump up and mount the boss and fight it from there. Still, breaking all the roots will end that phase, but if you're not fast enough, apparently he's going to start spinning around the entire arena, like some sort of horror version of that one Fall Guys mode. I love the concept of the fight, even though, yeah, it's relatively static, but there's just a lot of fun evasion to do throughout this fight, no matter where you are, teaching you to deal damage while on the move and make use of your iframes. So I think it looks great, it feels great, and it was really fun to fight the first time. The negative of this fight, I think, is how I think it'll be less exciting after the first few kills, as that spectacle wears off. And that's why I put it lower on the list, since other behemoths feel more satisfying to fight and overcome after many, many hunts. So moving on to third place then, we have the Magna Monkey, Torgadoro. Torga has a really cool design. It's set in a volcano arena in which this magna monkey climbs around and leaps for seismic slams. Just like Rajang, this guy has skipped leg day every day of his life. His arms are no joke though. It's like the classic monkey madness monster fight mixed with fire element. Big fist to punch, smash and crack your weak hunter body while bouncing around the arena. He can even enhance his punching power though, where he digs into the ground and encases his arms in earth for like big rock gauntlets. And as I experienced, his powerful punches can easily one-shot you if you're not higher level in your blaze escalation, so good luck with that. There's something really satisfying about the fight outside of its visual design. He's covered in rock armor, trying to enhance his abilities, and you're basically trying to break it, shattering his rock gauntlets, breaking his head apart, and turning him from the boulder into, ideally, the pebble. Dauntless makes use of an important damage type that's called part damage, and that's essentially a huge part of this fight. What's incredible about the guy, though, is how destructive he is. Many of his attacks will just, by proxy, rip the earth apart and spew magma everywhere. He'll throw rocks at you ripping from the ground. He'll leap forward and sunder the earth upon impact. He'll shockwave slam from up high, which then devastates the arena and sends out an insta-kill seismic shockwave that if you don't dodge, you're just dead. I did not dodge it. When charged up, he can Beyblade spin around. He can clap his hands together for air-shaking shockwaves. And of course, he has a command grab similar to Rajang himself, where he smashes and drags the player all over the floor. Kind of reminds me of that one scene with Hulk and Loki in the Avengers. There's just something wonderful about this fight. His design is really satisfying. The audio with every attack, leap and slam or whatever, it's so heavy to match the bulk of him. How he armors up or sunders the arena as part of his abilities. And I think he's a lot of people's favorite for a good reason. And I'd love to see some version of him in Monster Hunter. Maybe like a Deviant Rajang, Magma Rajang. Now then, second and first place were very hard to choose between, but I've decided that my second favorite behemoth was Chronovore. This brilliantly designed arena and area in general has you fighting not an escalation boss, but a special behemoth that you must summon. Unlike the arena, I think Chronovore is actually quite boring in its design, despite being the newest monster added to the game. It's a radiant element creature, basically the opposite to Shadow, and this design does suit that, a magical manta ray that suits the angelic theme. But I just don't think it's that interesting in its visuals as a creature, but it does make up for it with its ability effects and its incredible mechanics, since it's able to use a massive roster of radiant abilities to its advantage. It feels like a big combination of many of the best behemoth fights, and then just turns it all up a notch. Take the Torga Shockwave Ring. Chronovore will send out radiant versions of that, but like 10 times the number. Matched up with the giant radiant bolts for a bullet hell you've got to get through, and try and knock Chrono out if you can. It's got satisfying sound effects like Torga, with say the powerful whip crack combo of the tail, and we're seeing those classic beautiful radiant attacks in many forms, like the laser beams, the burning sunbeams, his charged teleports, which can actually suddenly grab you and burn you in the light. So in general, it's honestly just things we've seen before with previous behemoths, but at a pace that's much higher with generally more output with each attack. You've got lasers, but now there's three of them. You've got a bullet hell, but it's much wider. There's shockwaves, but there's like 10 of them now. So while I think the fight was very fun and challenging, it's not as creative as what we've seen before. That said, I still really enjoyed this fight, and it's obviously a good fight since it's number two. I know I'm going to enjoy the grind of getting this one's equipment, because learning the fight and maximizing the DPS despite the threat is going to be very rewarding. Not everything has to be super unique in concept, it just needs to be fun, and Chronovore is very fun. Which now leaves the number one spot, my current favorite fight in Dauntless. This is the Umbral Worm, the Shadow Eel. It is, of course, Thrax. Thrax is something special. He's like the perfect peak of Umbral Behemoth, using void abilities and portals to the absolute maximum. It's a very clever creature who uses this void-style arena to its advantage, attacking you on multiple planes at once, through its portals, directly with insane movement speed, or of course, swimming through the very floor and attacking you from below. This fight was so fun, despite being super overwhelming the first time I did it. And that's exactly what a good behemoth should be. Scary as hell, but super fun, and makes you want to fight it more to get better at it. And while this evil eel is fairly simple in its behemoth design, it's all set at the end of an umbral escalation that you pass through a sort of dark portal that leads to the realm of Thrax. It feels like you've entered a very intense boss fight arena, and that's exactly what you get. Since this is a hyper-aggressive speed demon, you're having to constantly dodge and evade even his basic attacks. You can't be greedy with your combos and get locked in an animation against him. And the strange fellow is very clever. He can use his portals to suddenly extend the range of his attacks, opening a portal right next to you to stab at you with a claw suddenly, or attacking you in basic ways with hyper quick attacks, body slamming the ground, tail sweeping around him, or just chomping on a slayer with a command grab. His speed is really shown when he's slithering around in his frenzy sliding attack, going back and forth at super speed. But things get really terrifying and very exciting when Thrax enters the Aether Charge state, where he sort of covers himself in umbral energy and becomes one with the arena you're fighting him in. Not only does he attack way quicker during his enrage, but now he's moving around at lightning speed on top of dipping in and out of the floor and portals for new attacks, during which he turns the arena into an even tighter playing field, zipping from portal to portal, cutting up sections which leave you with much less space to work with, during which he's going to leave tons of void spots that if you step in are going to corrupt you or maybe even flashbang you. He's using his portals more aggressively here, diving in and out, slamming down right on your location, or pouncing from portal to portal. When this state finally ends though, he even charges up and explodes out in sort of a umbral energy bomb. But like I said, for me, this fight was just so fun despite being super overwhelming. Both the monster and the arena are visually brilliant and actually play a direct role in the fight itself. And all this did was make me want to fight Thrax like 100 times more and just get better at the fight. And like I said, it feels like the peak combination of the Umbral monsters before it, taking what we've seen before and enhancing it in a really cool way. That's what an escalation boss should be. So I absolutely love Thrax, and I'd love to see something like him in Monster Hunter one day. But there you have it. Those are my 5 favorite behemoths in Dauntless, and maybe even 5 monsters I'd like to see in some form in Monster Hunter one day. But I mean, we don't have to wait for that. They exist in Dauntless, so if you want to go fight them and try them, you can do that. Like I said, I've really found endgame Dauntless to be very fun, and hopefully I'll be set up for the next whatever update so I can experience that at the same time as everyone else. If you want a proper look at the game from both positive and negative sides, you can check out my full video on my first impressions of Dauntless in 2021. But what did you think of the behemoths we talked about today? Would you order these any differently? I know some people swear by Targa. But until next time, I've been Hollow, you've been you. Thanks for watching.
Josh, Cotton, and Hollow with the videos, dropping the humor like a hammer on your tippy toes, bringing entertainment on a daily arrangement to take our insanity and turn it into entertainment. Yes, I said entertainment twice, to reiterate that it is nice to look into your faces on a mostly daily basis when you let us in your homes to make the whole world a stage. Goodbye.